welcome to this week's episode of
Hey, I think we're good here.
I'm one of your co-hosts, Jackson Metakekia.
And I'm Matt West. And we're here getting to know the sport of volleyball through the life experiences our guests have to share with us. Come take a listen. Today's episode stars current USA National team setter Lauren Carlini. Lauren takes us through her rise to Wisconsin volleyball fame, detailing her many experiences starting at the ripe age of 6 years old at Sports Performance. She describes a militant fashion in which she learned how to play volleyball, getting cut from her 14s team, and learning that just because she was good didn't mean she could act like a diva. Her early decision to be a part of the Badger volleyball family. The connection she had with Coach Kelly Sheffield. The program's immediate transformation into a national championship contender, playing on some of the best teams in the world with some of the best players in the world, especially opposites, and much more. Enjoy.
Talk low. What's up?
Whole lot of nothing.
Sweet. Well, welcome to the podcast. Thank you for coming on.
Thanks. Of course.
We're excited to have another setter on. We keep, I think inherently, we just keep getting setters because we're both setters. So we're just like, let's just get another one on. These people make sense.
Yeah.
These people get it.
We just get it, all right? We have to think for everyone else and ourselves.
Yeah, we're paid babysitters. Overpaid babysitters is what we are.
Yeah. Sometimes, yeah, therapists. Depends on the day.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying.
At least with women's volleyball. I don't know about men's, but.
No, it's the same with men.
Mm-hmm.
For sure. But anyways, the first question we usually start with is just, how did you get into volley?
How did I start volleying? Well, it all started with my mom. She played volleyball in college at Appalachian State in North Carolina. And after she had me, I mean, she was playing up until I think like 8 months pregnant with me and just doing like women's Wednesday night leagues in Illinois. And so as soon as she had me then, she just went right back to playing in all these nightly leagues for like older women. Late 20s. And then that's kind of when I started just right away. And so then I started playing club officially when I was 6 years old. Ended up playing club for 11 years. And I know.
Were you dry this whole time?
Basically, yeah, I was. I was a dry for 11 years, which I think is a record, you know, not surprisingly. So yeah, it was just like from day one, super disciplined, super on top of it, like military style training, which I loved. Like that's where I thrived. And then ended up going to Wisconsin for 4 years. And then 4 years after that, here I am.
I heard that you wanted to go to Wisconsin for like ever.
Yeah, like coming out of the womb. Basically, it was really random, but there was this girl named Maria Carlini and she was playing at Wisconsin when I was coming up through like elementary school and middle school. And I was like, that's super cool. She has my last name. Like, let's go check it out. So I started going to camps, found out we were not related. She's Canadian. But just had the same last name and I thought that was dope. So that's kind of how I initially got into the Wisconsin pipeline. And then I got to know the coaching staff really well just through camps and going there every summer. And then committed there my freshman year in high school. And yeah, stayed the course.
It's Wisconsin volleyball.
It was tough. I was on a this like seminar the other day and the girls were asking like, so when did you get recruited? And I'm like, oh, I hate this question because it's like so unorthodox to commit so early. And especially now it's illegal. You can't even do it until like your junior year. So I was like, this is totally not relevant anymore, but I committed super early. I do not recommend doing that because you don't know what you want when you're 14, 15 years old. You know, you barely know what you're going to have for lunch. So don't recommend.
So when you were 7 years old playing club, what age group did you play with?
I started with tens.
So there is a tens division. Wow.
There is a tens division, believe it or not. All the kids whose parents were crazy and were just like, you know what? We need them out of the house. Go play volleyball. Like, go play with your friends for a while. So, yeah, I was playing with tens for like 3 or 4 years.
That's insane.
It was fun because, like, I always played up 2 years. And then starting my 14s year, that's when I, like, let my age group catch up. So then I played 2 years 14s. First year was with older girls. Second year was with my age group. And then I skipped all the odd ones. So I did 10s, 12s, 14s, 16s, 18s.
No, that's the dream. I mean, I played – okay, in Seattle, we had, like, 8 guys. And that was it. So whoever was okay.
– At what age?
Whoever was the eldest, that's what age group you had to play. Magically. We always had
for like 14 round up to 18. Got it.
Magically, we always had like a senior in high school that came out of the woodworks and was like, I want to start playing volleyball. We're like, well, I was like, man, I thought this was my chance to play 16s as a 12 year old. And it's like,
yeah,
playing 18s again.
If he's 18, I'm 18.
Yeah, that was literally my whole life. And then I graduated high school at 17, so I never even got to play. I was never 18. To play U18.
Aww.
I never got to relish in it, you know?
Yeah, you never got to be the big dog. You were always the youngin'.
I was the young pup.
Sad.
My whole life.
Young pup.
The young pup. The young calf. You like Spry's militaristic tactics?
Yeah, I learned to love it. At first, I surely did not because I had enough of that at home. Like, my dad was pretty strict and really just with the rules, loved it. But, I mean, long story short, I tried out my first year. No. I was there for, like, 6 years, maybe 5, 6 years. And then 14s came around and tried out like we do every year. And this coach, who ended up being my favorite coach of all time, he cut me. And I was like, what the hell? So I go to the bathroom. I call my dad on my, you know, Motorola Razor phone. I'm like, Dad, they just cut me. I'm so confused. I've been here for 5 years. Like, I don't understand. Like, I'm good enough. What's going on? So then my now favorite coach is like, yeah, well, you got an ego problem. And I was like, oh, do I now? basically just trying to teach me a lesson about like being a good teammate, not having an ego, like sit down, shut up and get to work type of deal. And so he started off that season by cutting me and then me having to basically grovel and ask my way back onto the team. And to this day, we're still really good friends. And, you know, that's my guy. But that was a tough lesson at the moment. I was like, are you kidding me? I've already spent 5 years here. This is BS. I don't know if we're allowed to swear on this podcast or not.
No, you can do whatever you want on this podcast.
Yeah, that's a good move of him to a 14-year-old. That's bold.
Yeah. I think I needed to be knocked down a few steps. So, like, he knew I could take it, even if I was crying in the bathroom. But sometimes you just need a good cry.
Yeah, that's what I've heard. I haven't taken advice yet and gone down that road, but I've heard everybody needs a good cry every once in a while.
Even when you're in COVID quarantine, you haven't cried yet? My God, good for you.
Man, I was loving it. It's just volley all day. I'm just like watching 12 hours on volleyball. But going back to your ego problem, this is fascinating stuff. Did you – because every – like – fairly highly touted athlete has an ego problem between the ages of like 20 till whenever. I don't know, like 22, I guess, you kind of start figuring out like, oh, there's actually people that are really, really good at this. Mm-hmm. Was that same coach, was he usually the one that like kept you down? Not kept you down, but like kept you in check? Or were there other people involved too?
He was the one that kind of started it. And he was my first year 14s coach, and he we worked more than the 18s teams. We were in the gym more than them, and we couldn't even drive yet. So that's saying something. And he just taught us about work ethic and getting in the gym. And like, if you want something, you're going to work your ass off to get it, period. Like, nothing's going to be handed to you. And so he really instilled that for me. At least, especially I felt it like every day coming in the gym, you knew that you were going to get that work in. So then after him, he actually left the next year. So I didn't get to have him again. But there had been a couple of club coaches along the way, though not as strong. So I would say my ego was still kind of there, and it would get stroked a little more than if I did, if I was with him. And then college came, and I kind of knew how to be a good teammate, but not a great teammate, and definitely not a captain at that level, at the collegiate level. And so my college coach, Kelly Sheffield, he helped a lot with that too, in terms of not knocking me down, but just saying like, hey, like, yes, you're really good, but this is how you can help your team be better. And it's going to, just like leveling me out and helping me out, like knowing where I was, but then also kind of, I don't know, working together to figure out, okay, how can we make this the best possible situation for everyone? So, yeah.
For sure. My mom, I was fortunate to have my mother and my father as my coach. My mom was more
fortunate.
Yo, for sure. My mom's an Olympian. So having an Olympian to help you is like, okay. Great. Yeah.
You learn something new every day. That's fantastic.
Yeah, for sure. So my mom was the one, like anytime I came back for some high performance thing, I'd be like, yeah, high performance. I got stuff. I'm king.
Blah, blah, Mac blah. Daddy.
And she would just crush me. She'd be like, you think you know like everything, blah, blah, blah. You're shit. But in Spanish, I was like, damn it. But I honestly, I don't know how you were. This is my question to you. Because for me, I kind of knew I was getting an ego.
Mm-hmm.
And I would come back and be like, let's see if she notices. And then I kind of waited for her to put me down. Did that happen to you too?
Yeah, not with my parents. They're like my biggest fans and they think I am perfect. And I'm like, I am so far away from perfect. It's insane. But thanks for the support. I think kind of like you, as you get older too, you just become more self-aware of like, okay, why am I thinking like this? Like, I am not the hottest shit to walk this planet. Get over it. Get over yourself.
Yeah.
So I kind of learned that as I went through high school. But then especially in college, I was always so careful about like my wording, whether it be to my teammates or to newspapers. Like you never, I don't know, I guess I kind of learned not to put myself above other people. And like put myself on a pedestal. I always tried to, I don't know, diminish, I guess, in a way, and like redirect always towards the team or what we were focusing on. So I think I've gotten better with that as I've gotten older. And now, honestly, it's kind of hard to have an ego like at all. Everyone's just, I always feel like everyone's so much better than me and I'm chasing people now. And I don't, that just wasn't the case in high school.
For sure. Ego's kind of tricky, though, because you need one to be good.
To an extent, yeah.
Right? So, like, do you find it tough to balance as well with, like, the new challenges that are arising in international volleyball for you and just going up and, like, diminishing yourself, essentially? Do you also feel like you have to build yourself now? Like, it's almost gone to, like, a point of diminishing returns where, like, I think I might need to start building myself up a little bit more.
For sure. And of course it depends on the day and like kind of the flow you're in. There's some parts of the season you're just vibing, like you're playing great, okay, we're just at this level ground. And then there's other times or other seasons, even like my first year in Italy, my first professional year, struggle bus, like I was driving that bus. But I got to the point where I was like, okay, I know I'm good, but I am playing like trash every single day. Like, I don't know how to help hype myself up or get myself out of this. The next year, I kind of learned there was going to be ebb and flows, of course, throughout the season. But kind of like what you were saying, so important just to build yourself up and say, okay, listen, you're here for a reason. Like, believe that you're this good and believe that you are supposed to be where you are. So yeah, I kind of just going back to like, you are here for a reason, believe it and start playing up to your potential. So yeah, I totally agree. Especially as a professional, like you can't get down on yourself. This is what you're paid to do. Like, build yourself up to where you gotta be.
For sure. Do you remember who we were talking about or talking to, Jackson? We were talking about positive self-talk. What interview that was?
I don't remember who it was specifically, but self-talk is a big part of the ego, whether it's present or not present or whatever it is. Like, the way you're speaking to yourself, like, you're not going to be mean to anyone else, so why are you going to be mean to yourself?
That's a tough one.
But we were talking about it, and shit, what was I going to say? God damn, I totally forgot. We were talking about positive self-talk.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, how like when you look in the mirror, right? And like, you have those moments where you look in the mirror and you're like, all right, I'm the tits. I got it. I'm the man. Like, I'm the greatest. Like, those moments at 2:30 in the morning, we're like, I am so good at this. I don't know. And you're like, I don't know why at 3 p.m. I don't think the same thing. And then for some reason, everybody thinks positive self-talk is like one talk in the mirror after a nice shower. We're like, I'm the best. I'm the greatest thing ever. But in reality, it's like some days it's all day. Like, from the moment you wake up, you're just like, all right, I'm going to make the hell out of these eggs. You know, like, I'm going to do this. I got this. I'm pumping myself up today because I just.
Dang, I need to be more like you, Matt, over here.
Yeah, I'm just
hyping yourself up, making avocado toast.
Yeah. Yeah, and then other days you just wake up and you're just like, I feel pretty good. I don't need it. But those days where you just wake up feeling down and you're just like, all right, come on, man. Figure it out.
I know. Well, those are the tough days, too. I agree.
I mean, especially with how unique your guys' lifestyle is, living in a different country around different speaking people, different culture, everything. How do you kind of manage that day-to-day stability?
Kind of depends. Honestly, at least for me, it used to be really my mood, how I was feeling about myself, how I woke up. It correlated a lot to what was going on the court and how we were doing. I've kind of learned to detach myself a little more now I've gotten older. It's so important just to, like, once you're done off the court, try and walk away, distract yourself, find other hobbies and things to do when you get home. Because you're thinking about a 25-8, it is, like, exhausting. And so, I don't know. I just, as I've gotten older, I've just tried to not think about volleyball when I'm off the court. It gets tough, but I think it helps at least me. Now I have two other Americans on my team as the foreigners. So it doesn't feel like I'm in that foreign of a country. I'm all alone. It doesn't feel like that, but other situations are totally different. Like, Matt is in the middle of the boonies of Turkey. So I can't imagine how you're dealing with it every day, but depends on the person too.
For sure. For me, I don't know how you are. I didn't come from like a militant background, but I for sure was huge on like reps. I was like, mm-hmm. If I set X amount of balls today, that's a great day.
Mm-hmm.
And I still am. I'm not like, you got to end on a make or whatever, but I'm like, I got to end on a good feeling.
Fair.
Like, I don't care if it goes in, but if that ball feels great coming out of my hands 5 times in a row, I'm done. And if that takes, I heard Urban Meyer say this. He's like, I don't care how long it takes us to get 1 hour of good practice. If it takes mm-hmm. us 8 hours to get 1 hour, then it's going to take 8 hours. And I remember thinking, that's how I was in high school, where I was like, if it has to take me 2 hours in this goddamn hoop to get 5 really, really good feeling balls, then that's how it's going to take. And if it takes 5 minutes, then it's going to take 5 minutes. But that's just like, that's how it's going to be. So for me, if I have a horrible day,
mm-hmm.
like horrible, sometimes I just like bring out the hoops.
Get that feeling like good vibes going into the next day.
Yeah. So then I can at least walk out of there. Or if it's just like a serve and pass day kind of, and you're not doing a lot, then I'm like, all right, I need to do something to like make it feel like I've invested something in my day. So bring out the hoops. But as long as I come out of it, like I invested something, I gathered something from this day, then I can sleep peacefully.
Fair enough.
But it's those, man, those days where you walk out of there and you're just like, what happened?
Yeah. You're like, that was tragic. But then you kind of, you kind of think of it like, okay, it literally can't get worse tomorrow. So that's a good thing. Tomorrow's bound to be better than today.
Oh yeah. How do you, I have a question for you. I texted Micah Christensen about this because I had two of the worst days of my life where it felt like the ball, it felt like the ball couldn't get over the net. I was like, God.
Yeah, dude. Fair.
You know what I mean? Like, those days, yeah. Like, oh, this is brutal. I was like, dude, I'm having brutal days. How do you get through this? And he told me, he's like, I just simplify it. And I was like, all right, that's cool. Like, that's good for you. I'm the opposite. Mm-hmm. I'm like, I have to do something so absurd to like almost wake myself up out of this trap.
Uh-huh.
How do you deal with really shit days?
Yeah, I would say, okay. I think I'd go a little bit more with what he said in terms of simplifying it. So I'll go in, say I have like three big focuses for the day and everything has gone to shit. This practice is going terrible. I'm like, how can I set a ball without doubling it? Blah. I'll be like, okay, right now I'm about to focus on being under the ball in neutral. Like, that's it. I don't care where it ends up. I don't care about any of that. I'm just going to be under the ball in neutral. So I'd say focusing on something, but almost making it not about the set in general, if that makes sense. Like, sometimes I try and distract and be like, okay, I'm not even going to worry about setting because this is so tragic right now. I just want to get good defensive touches.
Right.
And then when I'm worrying about defensive touches, magically the setting part starts to pull itself together because my mind is not thinking about setting at all. So I'd say those are the two things, just like simplify and make one big focus or make that focus completely opposite of what you're trying to work on. So then your mind has to think about that. It works for me. I don't know if it works for other people, but like,
oh, no.
distract.
You know, Marv always used to say that. He's like, if something's going bad, just start. He's like, just cover. Like, start thinking about something for your teammates. So he's mm-hmm. like, the easiest one is like, just start covering. So like, if I'm ever in the trenches, I'll just start yelling cover.
That's when we know things are going to shit.
Yeah, just start covering everything. Because I'm like, man, if I can't do that, I was like, I got to do something.
Right.
And like,
whether it's positive block touches, something.
Yeah, for sure I'm going to have to cover these balls because these sets are a little crappy. So we're going to have to cover today.
Oh my God. You're helping yourself. That's what you're ultimately doing.
Just keep recycling, guys. That's what I say. Just keep recycling.
I love that. Wait, I'm stealing that.
Oh, yeah. Or like, if I'm ever having a bad day with high balls, I'm like, guys, I'm putting everything 50-50. Just go joust.
Yeah. Just hold and block out. Yeah.
I'm like, guys, just joust. Or recycle it. You know, just push it in and we get another chance.
There you go. Produce, reuse, recycle.
Unbelievable. How was your time at Wisconsin? Because I went to Pep and, you know, Firestone Fieldhouse is huge. It holds like 1,500 people.
It holds more than that.
Okay, 2,000. And I've always been curious because Wisconsin, how was Wisconsin before you got there? Because when you got there, it was lit.
It was litty. Oh, I miss college so much. Everyone's always like, okay, I even say it now. I'm like, embrace the moments you have because that is the best 4 years of your life, at least for me. But before I got there, it was okay. They were good in like the early to mid 2000s. And then from like late 2000s to when I got there, bad. Like just not making the tournament even, finishing really low in conference, just struggling. And so
this did not there was a coaching you from wanting to commit at all.
No, because I wanted to be like a part of something. Like I wanted to build it back from the ground up. And I just kind of liked that challenge of going in. And so even my senior year in high school, they changed coaching staffs from the staff that I'd known for 6-7 years by now. And this new guy, Kelly Sheffield, came in and it took one call. And I was like, this is my dude. Like, we're going to do some good things together. We just had like the same exact plan of what we wanted this program to look like and achieve and la-di-da. So, yeah, it wasn't great going in. And then what do you know, freshman year, new staff comes in, our freshman class comes in, and then we make it to the national championship on our first go round. And that was just like Cinderella story ride. And it was really cool to experience. Sophomore year, Big Ten championship, and then junior, senior year, not awesome finishes, not the same. It was like Sweet 16, Elite Eight. And now, though, we have this culture of like, okay, we are competing for championships every year, whether it's Big Ten championships, national championships, and we're getting all these big name recruits. So it's pretty cool to see something that you helped build from the ground up again.
It was tough watching the finals last year because they played so well, but they just you just didn't have a shot against that Stanford team.
No, not when you have that amount of like talent, firepower, and just overall strength in their game. I mean, they didn't have any weaknesses, yeah. Really.
But yeah, Wisconsin played really well. Like some of the digs, their defensive plays they were making was unbelievable. But
yeah,
just couldn't score off it.
Yep.
What was one of the biggest things that like resonated with you with Kelly when you first called him? Where you're like, this is my guy. Like, we're in it together.
Yeah. Good question. I think just kind of the passion and the lofty goals that he had before he even stepped on campus, bought a house or anything. He was like, listen, I know what I am capable of. I know what we are capable of together. And this program, like this is what I want to do and we're going to do it. And he didn't come in with just these like, oh, let's kind of see what happens. He came in like, we're going to be the best like passing and defensive team in the country, period. And set these goals from day one. So I think just hearing that from him and I don't know, just kind of wanting to bring Wisconsin back to the national spotlight. For me, I was like, this is my dream school and you're making it like this beacon again. So that's kind of what drew me to him initially.
And so your first day when you walk on campus, like, because it's a big thing that we talk about on this podcast a lot is culture and how do you establish culture?
Yeah.
How did he establish that? Because it's all kids that have obviously not been doing great. Like, it's a dormant franchise.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And so, like, how dormant do you franchise. Change – like, how do you change everybody's mindset and make them believers? And, like, was it just you, your freshman class as well, that could embody that and be like, hey, this is who we are now? Or, like, how did that happen?
It was actually pretty incredible because he got there in the spring. And so the girls, before I got there, those girls that had been on this, like, losing program, they got to experience him in spring training. And anyone knows like spring training is just tough. You're lifting at 6 a.m. and you're doing your practices in the morning and then you come back and you do it again at night. And it's just like a grind. And the great part about them and just that group is that they were from day one willing to buy in. Like they were all such hard competitors. They hated losing. They hated like
looking for a lead.
Yes. They're like, someone just please help. Like we want to do great things. We want to work hard. And it took Kelly just to come in and like say and kind of lead the way, right? So for me coming in, and they had already had spring and summer training all together. I came in a little later that year, but it was just like, all right, like we're all locked and loaded and ready to go. And we were just going to play hard. And I think the biggest thing was we didn't have targets on our back that year. No one expected us to come out and play as fierce as we did. But it was kind of that year of like, we're going to gain everyone's respect back, and no one is ever going to take us like a Wisconsin game for granted again. And think of us as like the pushovers. So yeah, just him coming in and saying, let's do this thing together. Like, you guys are willing and in here to work hard. Let's do it.
That's gnarly. Good for him. I mean, he also, it's kind of like the timing was also perfect because none of you were his recruits.
Exactly.
But for some reason, like, you guys just overlapped and coincided with him so well that it would, I mean, that does make it kind of a Cinderella story.
It, yeah, it really does. And just, we did this thing as personality assessments at the beginning of the year, and he still does this with all of his teams, and it's the DISC assessment. And basically going through and describing each person's personality on and off the court, how they best communicate with other people. And it's like a, like each person gets 56 pages or something ridiculous. But of course they narrow it down, and we have a 2-day meeting on it, I think, and just learning how to best interact with each other and learning why, you know, in stressful situations, some people just get really quiet and laser focused, and other people need to joke around and like laugh with others and stay loose to perform their best. So learning about your teammates that deep in detail, I don't know. I just think it really helps with connections on and off the court and bonding and kind of learning why people act the way they do.
Yeah, I think that is so important. The one, when I played in Holland, the one year that we won the league, mm-hmm. the only time that I've won the league since I've played in my sixth year, we had a psychologist and she did the same thing. Like, she just sat down, we broke everybody down, we would have a meeting mm-hmm. every month to like check on the team psychology, where we're at. And then I don't know how women are. Men are kind of different in the sense that, like, if something's going wrong, then everybody's just like, all right, everybody, you're meeting here at Saturday night. We're meeting at the bar. And however long it's going to take for us to figure it out, it takes. And, like, everybody, say your piece.
Mm-hmm.
And once you say your piece, then it's like, all right, everybody knows where we're at. And we can move on from this. And I think, like, I mean, that's not like psychological, but at least like you say your piece. So like having somebody come in and you get to understand each one of your teammates and it like specify certain things for you, that's like a tremendous help in my book.
It's huge. Cause especially there's some people whose personalities, they don't outwardly show that they care about things, like they right. internalize everything, and so like they have this poker face. You're like, are you even here? Like, do you even care? And yes, they care, but they just go about it a different way. They don't express it like other people do. So that was one of the biggest things shocking for me, because I am super like emotional in a way, but like expressive. Like, you know exactly how I'm feeling by how I look. And so coming in and like seeing people who didn't do the same thing as me, I was super confused. But once we had this meeting and kind of talked everything over, I was like, okay, the light bulb switched. I got it. I understand now.
Did you also talk to your teammates individually just to have an even better understanding of them after all that stuff happened? Or did that,
they're
freshmen, so it's kind of tough to do that. But like as time wore on, did you get better at it, or what, did that matter to you at all?
I would say luckily I knew most of the girls just coming up through high school and them being at Wisconsin and all the camps and stuff, so I was able to have those conversations pretty easily and openly. The good thing about our team was, at least my first year, we were pretty similar. We were all extremely high, like dominant and competitive people, and so we just kind of had a mutual understanding. There was a few girls who were, they call them S's, but like just steady and kind of these poker face people I was talking about, where I would have to have just extra conversations with, just to kind of understand where they were coming from and kind of what, how can I best help them? Because if I'm coming in your face screaming like, let's go, like we need to get our shit together, they're not going to respond well. So it's like, I had to have these conversations and say, hey, like Duello, like what can I do to help you in these situations? So those were super valuable. Just taking that extra time to help a teammate out paid off in the long run for sure.
With your pro teams, have you guys done anything like that?
Absolutely not.
Do you wish
you, you see that paycheck? What?
Do you wish you guys would or had?
You know, I don't know. I'm so on it. For me, we're doing a job and we're all professionals. So whether we like each other on or off the court or not, it doesn't matter. Like when it comes time to play and compete, like I expect everyone to go out and give 100% and like leave all that extra BS, whatever's happening, off the court. So I don't know. I mean, yes, it may help. I'm just not sure if everyone would fully buy into it like we did when we were in college. Yeah. Just different cultures. And you're only on the team for 1 year, like one season. Whereas in college, you're in that for the long haul, you know? I don't know.
Were you like this for your first year where it's like, it's pro, like every man for himself? Or were you still in college days where it's like, we're all supposed to be a team.
Like, kumbaya.
Yeah. Like let's all love each other and hang out.
You know, I had heard like expect something different, but I didn't realize how different it was going to be. So I think, yeah, I was in a culture shock. Just with that aspect of team dynamics, but then also like level of play, like you get thrown in, and I played in Italy my first year. And so it was just like, oh, so this is how 32-year-olds play. This is how, like, I had a girl on my team. Was it that year? Second year. She's 40, you know, like just completely different cycles of life that we're on and in. And I just wasn't used to that. So I think that's why I had such a hard time my first year, just expecting completely different culturally, and then team dynamic wise. Yeah, it's tough.
I remember you like talking to Maddie when it was your first year, and you're just like, this is a disaster.
Yes.
Like, this is not going as planned by any.
Yeah. No. And it was just like, wow, I hope every year isn't going to be like this, because I don't know how long I'm going to make it if that's the case. Because,
for sure,
like I said, struggle bus conductor.
Was it just
choo-choo, here I come. Looking back now and knowing the club and the situation in general, I jumped into the deep end in terms of management, coaching, all of that. Like, Italians are already very emotional to start. And then I have a manager. I had a manager and president who were older, knew nothing about volleyball, and was like expecting us to win every single match, even though the previous season they were in like fifth place or something. And we actually ended up really good that year. We ended up qualifying for Champions League. So I don't know, just between having a coach who just constantly yelled and so much feedback, my head would explode. And trying to get my feet under me professionally, it was tough.
Yeah. Then the next year you went to Navarra.
Yeah. What a dream.
Yeah, whatever, man. You walked out of there with the Champions League.
I know. It really, like, honestly, that year was the easiest year still, because Coach Massimo Barbellini, insanely talented, loved him. Our practices would last an hour and a half max. We're out of the gym. And just, like, get in, get to work, get it done fast, you get to go home. and I had another American with me. We won Champions League. Yeah, it was like easy peasy year.
How was dealing with Agonu?
It was – so remember when I was talking about being like therapist, a coach, a setter. Yeah, all these things.
Setter, yeah.
I definitely got good practice that year. Between having to like, you know, navigate, I'm sure as a setter, you're like, they're asking, okay, we need the balls 2 inches higher. You're like, oh, do you know? And then you go and you set the same exact ball and they're like, perfect. You're like, oh my God. yeah, there was a lot of that. Just like trying to keep my emotions in check. Thank God I had another American with me. It was just like, deep breaths, Lauren. It's fine. She's scoring all of our points. So, you know, just give her the ball. I'm like, all right. So, yeah, it was a little bit of a challenge at times. Just with egos and managing the amount of balls she got and other people getting upset that they're not getting enough balls. So it's always a balancing act as a setter. But it was good practice, that's for sure.
Yeah, going forward, it would like – can't get much worse, right? Because yeah. Then next year, I feel like you've had like the gnarliest opposites ever. Every single year. Then you went to Moscow the next year, and you had Goncharova.
Yeah, yeah. Who? It was great because like I couldn't understand what she was saying, so it was like I'm sure she was saying so many bad things, but I couldn't understand. So I was like, da da da. Yeah, completely oblivious, which was good. But that, I mean, Russia volleyball is just not my style, obviously, like just super boring for me. High balls to the pins, and that was it. So, not my cup of tea. Live and you learn.
Lucky you, COVID struck and you got out of it.
I know. And honestly, we were pretty much done with season. I think we only had 3 games left. Because we had already lost out of Champions League. So, yeah, we had only 3 matches left. So, we were on our way out anyways. Bless up.
And now you're in Turkey. How are you enjoying Turkey?
Now I'm in Turkey. I love Turkey. I don't know about you, man. I love this place. Like, I want to stay here until I finish my career.
Well, to Jackson. I said the exact same thing. I was like, I'd stay in Turkey for the rest of my career easily.
Yes. It just is such a good balance of everything. Volleyball is high level. Standard of living is really high, at least for like Americans and foreigners. Like we get paid pretty well. So between that and just being in a really cool place, great food, people are so helpful and so nice. I was not expecting that level of like service and helpfulness in a way. But yeah, even with COVID, this place has been a dream. Like I feel safer here than I do in the States. So if it's up to me, I'd like to stay. If they'll have me.
For sure. And you guys are killing it.
We're having a good year so far. Knock on wood. We have 4 tough matches coming up. But yeah, I really like the dynamic of this team and we have a really good culture and our coach definitely drives that. Like he's completely crazy, but he knows his shit. And so it's like, he's an Italian, but doesn't really act like an Italian. And yeah, he's tough, but in a great way. And I think our young team has just like been thriving off of that and his energy. So yeah, just trying to get through these last 4 games unscathed. And then go into January in a really good position.
That would be great.
Yeah.
That's sick. Is there something now that you've learned in this being your 4th year that you could tell yourself mm-hmm. when you were in Scandici? Or you could tell a young setter that's going over abroad for the first time?
Yeah.
And like in a tough situation, like a high pressure situation.
Yeah.
That like really stands out to you?
I think the biggest thing is don't let one bad day turn into another. I definitely got into that like just waterfall effect of like one day would go into another, which turned into a week, which then turned into a couple weeks. And it's just like, you can't let yourself, I don't know, you can't be your harshest, hardest critic. Like, there's going to be plenty of other people doing that for you. So control what you can control, step away, like mentally from the game as much as you can. And kind of like what we were talking about early, like at the end of practice, even if it was a terrible day, do something good to make yourself, I don't know, feel positive rolling in the next day of practice.
For sure.
And I don't know, I guess just going overseas for your first year. I've never heard anyone go into their first years overseas and be like, it was fantastic. I got MVP. We won the league. We did amazing. No, you're lying. Yeah. Okay. You struggled straight through that. So it's not going to be easy and you're going to live and you learn. But it will get better as long as you're an active participant in your own rescue.
It's like your freshman year of college. You're like, oh, this is so great. This is so exciting. Like, I get to do something new. I get to live somewhere mm-hmm. new. And then 3 months in, you're like, oh, it's kind of overrated.
Or way harder work than you thought it would be, balancing like school, volleyball, training, study hall, classes, like everything. There's so much on your plate. It's really hard to manage when you first get there.
Yeah.
And then professionally, I don't know about you, but when I went overseas the first time, I'm like, holy hell, what do I do from the hours of 11 a.m. till 5 p.m.? This is way too much time. Do I take two naps? Do I go on six walks? Like, what do I do with my free time? Like, I hated sitting around. That was miserable for me. Now I love it.
I don't remember what I did. I would always try to get lunch somewhere. I was like, does anybody want to go get lunch and kill 2 hours?
Mm-hmm.
And then I would come back. I can't take naps. They, like, ruin the rest of my day.
Really?
Yeah, I don't know why. I'm just not a napper.
You're just sluggish or negative Nancy or what?
Nah, I'm pretty sluggish, yeah. I heard, you know, actually my coach my first year told me, statistically, like, if you want to get the best sleep, or the optimal time for a nap is under 45 minutes and over 2 hours. And I was like,
What? Who sleeps for over 2 hours? You're going to bed at nighttime if you're sleeping over 2 hours.
Right. So then so when he told me that, it was pretty early in the process. And I was like, okay, I'm going to try this. I'm going to try naps for like the next 2-3 weeks and like test it, see how these go. So I put like, you know, I do like 44 minutes and I'd be like, oh, that's actually pretty good. And then I'd like, you know, like those ones where you're so tired where you sleep for like 3 hours and you're like, oh man.
What?
Like,
it's what over. Month is it?
Yeah. Yeah. Like, oh man, it's over. It worked. I'm telling you. And then when I woke up anywhere in between that, it was a disaster. I had the worst practices.
Wow.
I couldn't see the ball.
I'm more on the short and sweet end as well. I'm like, if I sleep for 30 minutes, prime time. I'm thriving after that.
Yeah. I always feel you on that. I also love this about Turkey. You play at like 2.
Yes.
It's so sick. You have the rest of your day to do whatever you want. And
go to dinner.
Yeah, I was telling
pre-COVID.
Maddie, yeah. I was telling Maddie, I was like, I don't have time to be anxious about the match.
Exactly.
Which I love. I'm like, I can't think about how I can mess up the match tonight. I don't have any time to do that.
It's incredible. Like 2 p.m., they first off, you don't even do serve pass. So it's like you wake up, you have your breakfast, you go to your game. Whereas if you're playing at 8:30, like you do in Italy, you are there when the sun rises and then you watch the sunset and then you're still not heading to the gym. And you're like, I've had 3 meals, 1 practice, but I've watched the sun set and rise and the game still hasn't happened. The worst. Yeah.
And like, I remember playing last year in France, I would like sit there and take a 2 hour nap, wake up, 2:30.
Yeah.
What else am I going to do today? And then we spend the next, I don't know, 6 hours or whatever, just pacing.
Yep.
Like,
thinking about all your tactics.
I don't want to think about this. I don't want to, yeah, and then you start overthinking. And you're like, am I underthinking? Am I even thinking? It's brutal. And then all it takes is, like, you just touch the ball once. And it's like, oh, I remember this.
Yep. It's oh, like, okay.
It's like, yeah, oh, but I've done
you don't like waiting 12 hours to do that.
No, I don't. Not by any means. I don't think most people do.
Nope.
Yeah. That's
what's your communication with the USA program right now? What are you guys kind of expecting coming up?
In there saying 2021 Olympics is a go. There has been no talks of like postponement, cancellation. They are 100% planning. So right now what we're doing, we've been meeting once a month as a USA team via Zoom. Two different groups. There's like the Asian countries who are playing and USA players. I think there's one or two that meet, and then the European girls. And we'll just go over kind of what's happening. Any updates, we'll talk to our psychologist, and it'll be about an hour and a half meeting. So we do that once a month. But other than that, the only way we're really communicating is if we're doing it on our own or through like volumetrics. They'll watch all of our matches and they'll comment on things and, you know, techniques, things they're wanting us to kind of work and fix on as we're going through our pro season. So that's been mainly how we keep in touch. And then the plan is when we get back from our pro seasons, probably have 10-ish days at home, depending on when we finish, and then head out to California and start training since most of us didn't get the chance to do that last summer. So yeah, as of now, full go.
So crazy. Just the unknown, like, yeah, we think the Olympics are going to happen.
It better happen.
Yeah.
Oh, God. Yeah, it's just, and especially these people who are have been wanting to retire, right, and wanted to retire after 2020, and now they have to go play another professional season and then have one more year of training, preparation, and then hopefully the Olympics. It's just, like, so many unknowns. You can't plan anything. It's exhausting, but just got to hope for the best and do what you can in the moment to be prepared for when that time comes to get back in the gym.
How long do you think you want to play for?
I'm planning on stopping when I'm 29. So after 2024, I might do one professional year after that, just depending on like kind of where I'm at in my life and the situation. Sure. But I do not see myself playing past that. I already do not feel great physically. So I think at that point I'll be ready to step away from the game and kind of start a new challenge, a new path. But who knows?
Such a definite age.
29.
Yeah. Why?
Yeah. 29 years old and same, because it's like that's 2024. Like after 2024 Olympics, I think I want to be done.
Good for you.
So we'll see. Yeah.
I mean,
I know. Some people are like 38, 39. We'll see.
Micah Christensen was like 4 Olympics. And I was like, what?
Yeah.
4?
4?
Yeah, he wants 4. And knowing Micah, like, he'll get a taste of 4 and be like, I could do 5.
What's 5? Yeah, but I already did 4.
1 more years. Whatever.
Yeah.
Jeez.
So we'll see. We'll see where I'm at in my life, but I don't see myself going past that.
What do you see yourself doing after your career, though?
Jackson, that is a great question that I absolutely don't have the answer to. I don't know. I majored in retail and entrepreneurship in college. I don't know why. It sounded interesting at the time, but I'm not sure I'm super interested in that now. I'm not sure. I do like startups and entrepreneurship things, but I'm not super creative. So I would be interested in helping other people with like startups or new ventures. I have no idea what that would look like though. Maybe something with commentating, broadcasting. I don't know. I'm not very good with my words sometimes, so I don't know how well that would go either. We'll have to see. I think it's all about who I know and what opportunities arise when the time comes.
For sure.
I have a question for you as a learner.
A learner, okay.
Yes, and like how you learn. So Jackson and I have been going down this rabbit hole of this phenomenon. It's not a phenomenon. It's a philosophical way of teaching called ecological dynamics.
Oh, God. Jackson. My brain's exploding just listening to you. Okay.
It's really simple. Jackson, would you like to define?
No, you got it. You need the reps.
No, come on, dude, please.
You can define
it really simply.
Yeah, so the basis of it is instead of like me as a coach and you as a player, like you do a couple reps and I give you some kind of internal feedback, the idea is to set up an activity to where you're going to have to do what I want just by accomplishing the goal of that activity. So there's going to be less feedback from me to you, but you're going to somehow figure it out. It's kind of a, there's not just one way to do things. There's not one way to set. You and Matt set differently. You and whoever else sets differently, but you guys could get put in the same activity and accomplish the same thing, if that makes sense.
I think that makes sense. And I would agree that that's a thing, because at least from what I'm understanding, it's kind of like, all right, you're telling me to do something or putting me in a situation to be successful in whatever aspect you're wanting me to be successful in or achieve. And I don't know. I mean, I think that's just, I think team dynamics in general, like you set up the system and how can we find a way to work in this and thrive in that system? And people are going to go about it differently, but the end goal is still the same. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that made sense. I don't know if that's kind of on the same terms.
Yeah, no, that's definitely related.
Yeah, because if you think about it, like at the end of the day, there are certain plays in volleyball where like that guy has a high volleyball IQ or that girl has a high volleyball IQ, because it just makes sense from a creative, logical standpoint. But I wanted to ask you the question, because when you were at Spry and you were getting a majority of your reps put in, after every rep, were they correcting every single little thing you did? Or was it more like a, that's Lauren, that's her style, like now we're just going to set into a hoop 100,000 times and you're going to perfect that style?
At Spry, it was very information-based. Like you were getting feedback almost every single ball. And everyone, we were called the Spry robots for a reason. Like it was like an assembly line. You couldn't, if a Spry setter, if you're running forward, 1,000% you're going to set back along the net. Like, because that is just what our repetition and our feedback, that's what we were supposed to do. And that's what we were trained to do. As I got older, I had to almost deprogram myself and like, okay, Lauren, every time you run forward, don't set back, because people scout this and they know. So I think that's a dope part about being a setter too, is like, there's always a game within the game and you're trying to manipulate the blocking scheme on the other side of the net in the middles. I'm going to run whatever this middle on a set there or whatever you guys call it, a gap. And I'm going to isolate the opposite and then vice versa, and trying to move them while still being good, like technically for you. I don't know. I kind of like that game within a game and messing with the other middles and other schemes defensively. So yeah.
I'm curious. It's just interesting because you were saying how in Italy you just got bombarded with information.
Mm-hmm.
So then when you're at Wisconsin, was Kelly not giving you as much information? Because it's the opposite for me. In club, I got like zero feedback.
Man, so it's just free for all.
It was like, go play, go enjoy yourself. The only feedback I got was, are the middles jumping or not?
Okay.
And like, other than that, it was like, just run an offense. And like, if the middles are committing, you can do whatever you want from there. Mm-hmm. And then in college, I got bombarded. So it's like the was did Kelly what did I mean? The hell did Kelly tell you? Did he tell you a lot, or did he kind of like leave you?
No, Kelly pretty much left me. He kind of started the process of like deprogramming some of my tendencies, yeah. Which was good. So then teams couldn't scout me quite as easily. But he didn't give me quite as information. Of course, we have our scouting reports, but in the games, it wasn't constant feedback. It was just like, hey, read the game, go do you, and I'll let you know if something is changing or we need to, you know, adapt and adjust. But for the most part, I did my own thing and got a little bit of information from him. So yeah, I think that was also hard. Then going into Italy my first year and a coach yelling at me in Italian and broken English all the time. And you're like, I don't know what to do. Stop yelling at me. And freaking out. So yeah, it just, and it changes every year. Like this year, my coach, so much information. He doesn't even know when he's giving information. He's just blah, 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 a million miles a minute. And you kind of have to learn how to tune him out because he really doesn't know he's giving that much information. But it's like, you kind of, we get to the point in our career where like, all right, I'm going to take this little bit of information and this little bit of information and the rest of this I don't need right now. I'll save this for a later time.
Sure. Which do you prefer or which do you excel in? Like, would you rather get a very small amount of information? Would you rather get no information or all the information?
Damn, that's a good question. I would say all the information, at least where I'm at right now in my career, give me all the information and then I can minimize from that. Like I can pick and choose what I want to use in the game. But I feel like if I go in and I have no information at all, I don't know. Yes, I'm playing free, but I also don't really have a rhyme and a reason to why I'm doing what I'm doing.
For sure.
What about you? I'm curious.
That's a good, like, we've been having this talk for the last 2 weeks now because mm-hmm. we have some friends that are, like, really drinking the Kool-Aid and they're all in. And I'm like, you can't. I was like, I don't know if I can be all in. I feel like you kind of need both sides of the coin to be successful.
Agreed. You need that freedom to be able to kind of play and do you.
Creative, for sure. You need like you have some kind of creative process, but you also have to have like principles as to why you're doing something.
Exactly.
Right? But I think for me, I think I'd want to know nothing.
Because that doesn't surprise me.
I would want to know nothing because I'm like, I learn pretty fast by watching. Mm-hmm. And like, it's, I mean, I watch a ton of volleyball on my own free time. So like, that's just how I mm-hmm. analyze things. So like I've told Jackson, I was like, if you give me a set, I'll know everything.
Mm-hmm.
I can figure things out, right? So just by watching and analyzing and stuff, I can figure something out. But if you gave me everything and then I walked into the game, if I'm in a little bit of the wrong mindset, just a little bit, no, I'll go blank.
Really? Yeah, like information overload or you're just like, no, like just, literally like, no
I'll be,
idea.
I'll be thinking about it so much all day. And then mm-hmm. when I get to the game, like, okay. I'll just be like, what?
Yeah. Oh, right. See, it's like studying for a test and right. knowing all the answers. And then you get and look at the paper and you're like.
Yeah. So then like, I'll know the opposite's supposed to help with the gap, but then I'll set the gap and I'll be like, I knew that. Why did you do that? And I know that. Whereas like, if you give me enough information, which is obviously you learn this kind of on the fly and like over time, like in France, they gave me like pretty limited amount of information where like we would just watch a set and they're like, all right, like there's your scouting report. And I was like, okay, cool. Like that's good, you know, and like you kind of go in and I was like, that's not enough. It's not enough to formulate a game plan. And then they give me like a compilation of 30 minutes of like all the last five games in every rotation. So then like I can watch it till I get an idea. And I'm like, okay, I have an idea. I can formulate a plan. And then I'll make that plan based around my team. Because I do think a lot of people spend more time trying to plan against what they're going to do, which you have zero control. Right? And I'm like, okay, based on my and our team's offensive philosophy, this is what I want to do. And this is how I'm going to get them to do what I want them to do.
Well said.
You know what I mean?
The game within the game.
Yeah. Yep. But yeah. And at the end of the day, it always comes back to what my mom said of like, are they jumping? Like, are they committing? Like, and then
if not, set the middle.
Yeah. Exactly. It's like sometimes it's that simple.
Yeah. We really like to make things harder than they are as a setter. Okay. I know I do that too. And it's just like, oh, but I thought I saw this and they were moving this way on this ball. They're like, no, you're not actually saying this. Just set the middle. Game over. Yeah. You're right.
Yeah, or like
how often does it happen where you have a game plan set up and for whatever reason you just can't execute the plan based on the game, like your middle sucks that day or the passing is off. Like you have a plan, but you don't have the opportunity to execute it.
I would say sometimes previous years more than this year, just because this year, I kid you not, when we say that we watch video every single day for an hour before practice. So it's like we go over every single situation that could happen, will happen. So when we get to the game, like we have all this information already set in stone. Of course, there's time during the match where it's like, all right, our passing is struggling and I can't set the middles. So then that means we have one option basically as the opposite and they just have to go out and bang balls and hope for the best. But I would say at least with this team, it doesn't happen so often where our game plan just completely gets blown up and we have to like reinvent the wheel. Sure. Luckily.
Yeah. Well, that's great. I have for sure reinvent the wheel a couple times.
I can imagine. Is there one that like stands out that you're like, this game just went to hell and then this is how we adjusted?
Man, literally so many matches when I played in Czech. Because our coach, our assistant coach wanted us to run gap red till the day we, like, that's it. He was like, we only run gap red. I was like, I know that there are some dumb middles. I get that. But there's also some smart ones. And
I'm sprinkled in there.
I was like, there's going to be a time where we need to adapt. And I was like, what if I'm just not feeling setting like the gap well? Or what if we're having a really bad day? Then what?
Yeah.
So then it's like, yeah, there were times for sure. Like we would go down 0-2. I remember we came back down 0-2 seven times that season.
You're kidding.
I swear, because I would scrap the whole thing. I would be like, we're not doing it. We're going just running ones and pushes and like back ones. Like we're scrapping it. Boom, gone, over.
Yep. I think you set a Guinness World Record seven times. That's tough.
It was nuts. Yeah, but I was just like, whatever. Like, but we talked about this too before with Casey Kreider. It's like you have to do what's best for the team in order to win. So if some guys just aren't feeling good on a certain route, then you should have practiced well enough to be able to adapt and be like, all right, then scrap it. That's not the route we're going to run tonight.
You can't be a one-trick pony and win all your matches. Sorry.
No, it's impossible.
Got to throw a wrench in the plan sometimes and see what happens.
No, it's actually pretty fun sometimes too. We were like, let's just like, yeah. And those are the moments where you have to think, okay, just one point at a time, guys.
Yes, like, just play. Don't overthink things.
We're not trying to win the match right now with this play. We're just trying to open up some options here. Mm-hmm. And once we get into a rhythm and we're comfortable,
yes,
then we can come back.
The power of momentum is insane.
Yes.
Can't explain it. You can't quantify it, but momentum is real.
Yep. No, I completely agree. And yeah, I think, I mean, I know a lot of people think it's really fun to watch rallies and all this stuff. But when I watch setters cutting up people and it's like 60% FPSO on one side and it's 60% on the other side, and I have to wait till 23-23 to like, mm-hmm, see who's gonna win the match. Those are my favorite matches ever. Cause I'm like, man,
yes.
I'm like, you don't understand how much brain power is going into both sides right now. And they're just cutting each other up.
That's so fun. And then it doesn't happen so often anymore, but like going through and you're just dishing like all the goodies, yeah, and you're here in the middle on the other side, like shit, you know, like missing their moves. Oh my God. That just makes my day. I'm like, yes, more of this.
And you know, like, I don't know how, like, for all of you guys, for me, whenever, anytime I doubt a play call, I'm like, okay, the game plan says we're supposed to do this. But if I doubt it, mm-hmm, I'm like, I'm not calling it. I'm going with the gut instinct. And that's something I learned over time, too. And that's taken me years where I'm like, you've been playing this game for so long, man. Believe it. If you don't think that's the right call, you don't need to explain yourself. It's probably not the right call.
Exactly. Trust yourself. Well said.
For a reason.
Even that's so true, because then, I mean, I still find myself doing that sometimes where I'm like, oh, I know I have to run this play because my coach is going to chew my ass if I don't. But then I don't have confidence in the play. So then I'm still thinking about it as I'm setting it. And then, yes, it's a crap set. I set the wrong player. Something happens. So it's like kind of what you said, just trust yourself and trust your gut. Like, you've been doing this long enough and we're reading the game as we're going. Just go with what you know. Like, I don't know. Trust yourself. I love that.
Yeah. And, you know what the worst is, when – I've had this multiple times where like coaches want to win match point. They don't tell you anything. They don't tell you anything for five sets or three or four, whatever. And all of a sudden it's 13, timeout, Matt, I want you to run like one go or one bic. And it's like, my man, I have a plan. We are going to play it out. And you know what? In the past, I used to do what the coach said, and it never worked. Because like, what you're thinking is what they're thinking.
Exactly.
And what my guys think is what I'm thinking. So if you infiltrate our area, we're screwed. Because there's seven of us here that all know what's going on, and you just injected an eighth all of a sudden.
Don't be the eighth.
Yeah, don't be the
eighth.
Don't be the
eighth. That's so true. Sometimes that's the same thing. Just like, you have to have a certain pulse and sense of the team, especially as a setter. Like, all right, who's my hot hand right now? What is the other side doing? The coaches have a lot of other shit, yes, they're thinking about and they're seeing, but you're the one on the court with everyone and like hearing all the conversations being had, like, you're getting the full vibe. So you just got to trust yourself and your experience, especially going into those like tie break sets. Oh my God. All bets are off. Like, we're winning, period.
Yeah. That's that or whenever, I don't know how you are, but I literally have to tell myself this. When I kind of start going down, it's like, you know, when like everybody starts fading, a little bit of fatigue in like third or fourth set, and they rattle off like one or two cheeky aces, and then you kind of get like a crap ball, and you got to feed the side out. Literally, I'll be running, and I'm like, you got to play with balls, kid. And I'll do something like wild. Yes. Like sliding back set. It usually works. And then everybody's back because, like, there's energy. And then it's like, all right, we're back.
The energy shift.
Now flow is
coming. Exactly.
We got to get some flow here, guys.
I totally feel you on that. It was setting, but also defensively. Like, in my head, I'm always like, all right, dude, just get me a really crazy block touch so I can go chase this down somewhere and, like, pull it off defensively. Okay, if we get one crazy defense play, game back on. Yeah. Our energy and momentum shift changes like that.
Yes, and then just make the next serve.
Yeah. Oh, my God, please, for the love of God, not in the net. Our coach, he's so funny. He's so funny. He we were in practice one day, and we were missing a lot of serves in the net, and he was going on a rant. He's like, you are a child. You are children if you serve in the net. And then he goes on. He goes, can we not serve in the net until April? It's possible. And we're like, no. What do you know? The next freaking girl. Boom. Straight in the middle of that. He's like, get on the line. So now anytime any of the girls serve in the net, we just make a joke about it. And we're like, you're a child. Honestly, you're a freaking child. Just lightens the mood a little bit.
I have a teammate on the bench. Every time I go back to serve, he goes, don't hit him in the net. So I had to.
Is he 12?
I called him aside like a couple weeks ago, and I was like, hey, you know, when you tell me don't hit it in the net, the first thing I think is don't hit it in the net. And then where does it go? In the net.
In the net.
So I was like, I would really appreciate if you said, like, go, Matt. Encouragement would be great. Yeah. You don't have to tell me what.
Let's rip this serve.
Yeah.
Oh, hit God.
Hit the target. You know?
Not in the net. Was this every time you went back to serve?
Yeah, I think so. And then I just caught on once. And then he kept saying it. And I was like, hey.
Uh-huh.
Calm down. We don't need this.
Way to give them constructive feedback.
I was trying.
Yeah.
I did my best. Well, Lauren, I think we're good here.
All right. Yeah. Works for me if it works for you.
Thanks for coming on and laughing and talking to us.
Yeah. I'm so sorry you're in quarantine, COVID style. Hopefully you guys get a negative test. That's a bummer.
It's all good. It could be worse. We could be really – I mean, if we were really, really sick, then I'd be more concerned.
Fair.
But at least everyone's all right.
True. Could be worse.
Sure. Well, good luck the rest of the way, Lauren.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Four more games until break. Let's do it.
Let's go.
Well, thank you again, Lauren. We appreciate it.
Of course. Thanks for having me on.
Of course. We'll talk soon.
All right. Sounds good. See you guys.
Very good.
See ya.
Bye.